All right, time to start up. Here is Q&A number 18, my self-indulgent video where I talk about myself and my channel for like an hour. Think of it as like a one-man podcast. That's pretty fun. Okay, let's see. I like to do these every 2 weeks, but for like the past 10 videos, I've done it like every 3 to 4 weeks. So I think that's the new trend. I have it set on my calendar, my thing that's supposed to tell me when I'm supposed to do my stuff to remind me every 2 weeks, but I kind of ignore it because I was in the middle of something else at that time. Oh wow, my mic is like turned pretty damn low. All right, so let's see what's happened since last time. Halloween videos. See, what I wanted to do for the month of October was put out a whole bunch of Halloween-related videos, Halloween-related top tens, I should say. What I had planned to do is like put out like 5 or 6 top 10 videos, as well as an old god lore footage in between every week. It was an ambitious goal, and at the very end of it, I wanted to put out an interactive story, which would be kind of like a horror story, kind of, not really. I had an idea for it where you'd be chased through something, you have to run away. So, what did I accomplish? Well, I pretty much did what I wanted. I made a old god video, but that was in place of one of the top 10, so it's okay. I got like 70% of what I wanted to do. The big thing though is I got the interactive story done. That was the thing I absolutely wanted to have done, and I had that plan since the beginning of the month. So there's a reason I don't do those kinds of videos very often. They take a lot of planning and work, and if I were to make one every couple of months, well, I mean, there are some other interactive videos online if you want to look them up. It's so hard to find some that just aren't terrible. Like I remember when I made my first one, like two years ago, back in 2013, The Mage Who Leapt Through Time. I started writing the script in October because I wanted to have it done for Halloween, and that did not plan out at all. I had too ambitious of a script, and it took me way too long to write, and it took me like 3 months to write before I finally had it down, and it took me about a week to put the video together because I had to learn how to, because it's also the first Machinima video I ever made. I had to learn how to use Model View and all that shit. But in preparation for that, I also looked up other online interactive stories on YouTube, and the ones I found were either like it was just one linear story where you could choose deaths, but you can just press backspace and go back to the story. There was only one path you could do. There wasn't really no choose your own adventure. It was you either choose the right choice or you die. A real choose your own adventure story will have multiple like actual endings you can get to that are relevant to the plot, in addition to lots of deaths. Not just lots of deaths, but only one story you can reach. So The Mage Who Leapt Through Time, the one I made 2 years ago, that one, it has two endings. Two very well thought out endings that took me way longer than I'd like to admit writing. But I'm glad I took so long writing it because I still like that video today. It's probably like my favorite video I've put out on my channel. And Into the Crypts is not that much different. I didn't spend anywhere near as much time writing it. I think I only spent like 3 days total writing this one. But that's because I kind of knew what I wanted to do. I was just going to map out what the crypts look like. I knew how to get into the crypts, and I basically just explored it. And I built the video around the map of the crypts. So if you play the interactive story enough times, you'll actually know the entire Charazhn crypts inside and out. Like if you go in there and you're, like an expert, have played through all the options like a million times, you'll know exactly where to go inside the crypts because it's 100% based on the actual layout. Luckily, the crypts are not that big, but they're not also, super small either. It was like the perfect size for a story like I wanted to do. Yeah. What was I going with that? Oh yeah, I was gonna talk about videos I've made since last time. Well, since I'm talking about the Crypts, I might as well just continue. The Into the Crypt story. I planned to make this video back at the beginning of the month. I knew what I wanted to do. I had a vague idea for it. I just kind of... Well, I mean, coming up with the idea is not that problem. Not that big of a deal, and writing the story isn't really that big of a deal. I write stories all the time. Short stories that... I usually just turn them into Dave and DevBot stories now. Every time I have a story that I want to write, I write out a Dave and DevBot script for it. I have so many of those just waiting to be made into videos, and so little time to make them. But yeah. So I just got the story together. What I wanted to do was have it a story where you don't actually ever see the monster. It's the fear of the unknown. If you're wondering why you never actually saw the actual monster that's chasing you around, that's because if you reach one of the endings, it'll tell you exactly why that is, and it's basically spoiler alert, there is no monster. The guy's just insane. I thought that was a cliche way to do it, but I thought it was good and fit the story nonetheless. Cliche or not, cliches are meant to be used and abused, and I use and abuse all of them, and it's great. If you know enough about storytelling, you can pretty much, make anything you want. Because you have to remember that a lot of people don't know that much about storytelling. A lot of people are very ignorant to these kinds of things. They don't pay that much attention to it. And that works out perfect for me. Because I am not a great writer by any stretch of the imagination. I'm just a writer hobbyist, I should say. I know all the tropes, and I use them strategically. I don't really make anything original, including the Dave and DevBot series. That's just kind of an amalgamation of a whole bunch of different things that I've copied from other people in a way that makes it seem like I created it on my own. It's not really the case. I think that's how pretty much everyone does it. They just pretty much write whatever comes to mind, and whatever comes to mind is usually influenced by past material they've read or experienced themselves. So I guess, in a sense, it's original, but I don't like to think of it that way. I just don't really care. I just write whatever I want. And if I need to change it later because it's obviously plagiarizing something, I will, but I don't do that. I'm pretty good about that. I like to think, anyway. It's not like I copied the stories from anything. I wouldn't just straight up copy a plot. That's stupid. I meant like copying little tidbits here and there. So yeah, the Crypts. How do they do? Well, actually, according to my analytics... considering all the videos, they got quite a bit of views, I think. Damn, views for the day when the Crypt video came out. 44,000. Not half bad. Only, like, one of those videos actually had ads on it, though, so it's not like I made a whole bunch of money or anything, but... Plus, all the videos were, like, less than a minute long. Still, you know, that's kind of... a nice little jump in views. Currently, the first video is sitting at about 5,000. Not half bad. It's a little bit better than I was expecting. I didn't really expect it to do that well. I expected a little bit more than Dave and DevBot numbers, so more than 2,000 views, but less than a top 10 video, so less than 10,000. And it's at like 5,000, so that's, you know, it met my expectations. Exactly. I have a pretty good gauge on how videos will do, and it did as well as I thought it would. Very, very rarely surprised by it, by my own expectations on this. I guess I know how my own videos will do on my own channel well enough. I'm pretty sure all YouTubers are like that. They'll know how a video they make does or not based on past experiences. Wow, the Mage Leapt Through Time, that video I made 2 years ago, has about 43,000 views on its first video. Not too shabby for a two-year-old video. And, okay, I guess that's enough about the Into the Crypt. What other videos did I make since last time? The Yogg-Saron video. Oh, the Yogg video. You see, funny story about the Yogg-Saron video. I wanted to make a video for all the old gods. I made a video for like a brief explanation of all the old gods a long time ago, and that video did pretty well. It's also on my list of like, if I make a video that I really like, I'll put it onto my playlist of my best videos. And the last time I put a video on my playlist was 9 months ago. I might add Into the Crypts to it though, because I kind of like that. Even though I felt the story was kind of rushed, I still think the story is pretty good for a rushed job. Like, I was actually surprised I was able to think up as many endings as I did. I mean, there's only really, like, there's 5 endings to the story. There's the one where you escape the crypts by circling around and going out the water. And then there's the ending where you find out that there is no monster and you just walk out. And then there's the ending where you become enlightened and are able to bend reality at your whim because you figure out that you're inside a video. So you just simply move your body somewhere else. And then there's the ending where DevBot tells you how to get out. I basically just put the instructions like, here, this next annotation is going to take you back to the runaway option. And if you just follow the instructions that are on the, you know, the page, you'll be able to reach the good ending. And then there's the ending where it just takes you to the my other interactive story. I guess that one's not really an ending. It's more of like a death, since it takes you to a different story. But I mean, it could also be considered an ending. So I guess there's only like really 4 endings, but I counted it as 5. And I also put like, there's 5 endings on here. Even though there's really only like 2. The one ending where you get out and escape the monster. And then the ending where you find out there is none. Because the enlightened end is basically the same thing. You find out there was no monster. And that you're just crazy. And that the first video was told from an unreliable narrator. An unreliable narrator, for those of you who don't know, is someone who tells the story, but doesn't tell you all the details or just straight up lies to you. Say, for example, you are like in a locked room mystery. And everyone is accounted for. And you have no idea who got into the room to kill the person. No one has a key to the room. Everyone has an alibi for their story. And you have no idea who did it. And then you find out it was actually the person telling the story who was the one who did it, because he intentionally left stuff out. That is a trick in mystery. It's called the unreliable narrator, and I totally abuse that trope. But I didn't think anyone would really notice. I even said it in the enlightened end. Just like, oh, what if everything was just told by an unreliable narrator? I was like, well, you know what? A lot of people don't know about these tropes. They'll never get it. Or some people will, and they'll still just be fine, because even if I write a story like that, you know, just because it has tropes in it doesn't mean it's bad. Tropes do not equal bad. They're perfectly legitimate tools to tell a story. Although, if your story is nothing but tropes and super predictable, that's bad. Lots of Hollywood movies are like that. I can almost always predict the ending of a generic movie, and I'm almost never wrong. So I'm really, really happy when I watch a movie that doesn't have a predictable ending, or predictable characters, or predictable plot elements, because I've seen them all. Because I'm a huge connoisseur of watching movies and TV shows and anime and reading books and, you know, comic books and manga and YouTube videos and shit. I'm a huge consumer of stories. Because I don't think there is any kind of stories that are out there that I don't actually actively engage in. Let's see, I watch videos, I watch movies, I watch anime, I watch regular TV shows, I read books, I read comic books, I read manga, I read light novels. Yeah. I don't know. I don't have enough time since I do so much of that, so I guess I miss some of it. Yeah, whatever. Oh, what was I talking about? You know what, I think I was actually talking about the Yogg video. Shit, I always get so sidetracked at these things. Luckily, it seems like you guys love the sidetracks for some reason. So, I guess it's not really a big deal. For the Yogg Saron video, I got the research for it in like what I did was I just wrote down a whole bunch of pieces of research, and I had planned on putting it into a cohesive script with some kind of like flow to it. And instead, what I did was I just read the script from the research. I didn't really make any changes to it. And the result was a subpar video. I didn't really like it. I was like, ugh, I really should have rewrote this. But then again, I was already kind of late on the video. I wanted the video to come out on Wednesday, and I was already writing, no, like making the video on like a Saturday. It's like, I'm just gonna rush this out because I'm already behind on my pre installated schedule. I guess the schedule I give myself. I don't really have to follow any schedule. I can put them out whenever I want, but it's not a good idea to go too long without videos. And I didn't really like it because of that. Let's see. Next video after that, the Yogg video. It still came out okay. It's just, it could have been a lot better if I just had rewritten the script to just not be fucking facts about Yogg. It should be like, here are some fucking random facts about Yogg-Saruman that don't make any sense and are in random order. Creepy quest video. That one I thought would take a lot longer than it did. And it was surprisingly not that fast. Because I've made, like, when I made my top 10 quest chains video, that video took me forever to get footage for. Because getting footage for an entire quest chain takes a long time, considering usually I have to do a whole bunch of quest chains before you get to the quest chain, or the quest chain itself is, encompassing an entire zone, like the Silverpine quest chain with Sylvanas and stuff. Which was number one, I think, on that list. Yeah, I think so. So I thought top 10 creepy quest chains. It's like, oh, this is gonna take me forever. Luckily, a lot of the quests I ended up putting on the list, I had already had footage for from my Iron Man video. I'd already done a lot of them. And I'd also gotten quest footage from a couple other ones from, like, the Zombie Dragon video I did. Because one of the footage things required me to go to Hillsbrat Foothills and do a whole bunch of quests in order to get to this one other quest. And luckily, I'd already gotten footage for a quest in my quest chains video. And some of the other quest chains on the video were very short ones. Very short quest chains, or just like one quest. It's not like they were all quest chains, some of them were just like straight up just one quest. And they were pretty easy to get to, or breadcrumb ones. So I was expecting it to take a long time, so I prepared for it to take a long time to have it out by Sunday. And I was so happy to get it done by Friday. I've never gotten a video done early. I can't remember the last time I had a video done early like that. So I was able to spend a little bit extra time on it, I think. Yeah. That one was nice. That was a nice, easy video. I wish all videos went as planned like that. All the footage real easy to get. I already happen to have a lot of the footage. I like that video. And it's doing pretty well-ish. Let's see, next one. Dave and DevBot number 7. Dave and DevBot go fishing. For the handful of people who are Dave and DevBot fans, I'd say each Dave and DevBot video gets about 2,000 views. I'd say about half of those are ones who've watched all of them, and the other half are just ones who've saw it show up in their subscription feed and just decided to click on it to check it out. So I'd say there's about, I don't know, let's make it a conservative estimate. I'd say there's about 500 fans of Dave and DevBot, which is a pretty good number. So for you, handful, that's, well, I mean, I have like 3,500, no, 35,500 subscribers. So of the 500, I think those are fans of Dave and DevBot. It's a small number compared to my subscriber count. Basically, any Yu-Gi-Oh video I release over on my Yu-Gi-Oh channel, which takes about half an hour to make one of those videos, gets more views than Dave and DevBot, which takes way longer, hours to make. I don't know, how long does a Dave and DevBot video take? I already have the scripts done. Like, I have 20 more episodes just like in script form, ready to be made into videos. It's all about just actually making them. That's the hard part, because making machinimas takes a long time. How long, though? I don't know. I want to say about 5 hours. 5 hours of editing. That's a good estimate. Like, some videos don't take that long, and some of them take a lot longer, because you also have to. Because it's not like all videos have the same exact, like, settings and character animations, and they're doing the same thing in the same place. You have to go out and find locations and stuff, and finding locations takes time. It's like, ooh, this would be a great spot to have this scene in here. The character models, usually it's Dave and DevBot and then someone else. That doesn't really take too long. And then actually like filming them in place and putting the choreography to like what's happening on screen, matching the lip sync. Machinima lip syncing is, it's pretty easy, but it can also look really bad if you don't do it correctly. I've watched a whole bunch of Nixium's videos because I think he does it well. Where he has them, because you only have so many character animations to make your character look like they're talking. If you have him just stand still, it's fine, but it's totally noticeable if you have him stand still too long when they're supposed to be talking. So you want to have some kind of movement. And different characters have, you know, different talking animations, like the Torin model that Dave uses has two talking animations, plus an exclamation, plus a question mark. No, I think the question is one of his talking animations. So he has a talking animation, asking question animation, a shout animation, and I think that's it. I sometimes use the point animation too when I'm talking with him, so I like to cycle between those four. And each of those animations, like the asking a question one, is like 3 seconds long, the talking question one's like 5 seconds long, exclamation's like 2 seconds long, and pointing surprisingly takes like 3 to 4 seconds. So you have those to work with, and usually they talk for a lot longer than those kinds of seconds. And if you just loop the same thing over and over, it just looks like they're doing the same, you know, thing over and over. So you want to like stack up their talking animations back to back in a way that makes it seem like, you know, it's flowing in a certain way. You're allowed some, like, I don't go out of my way to make Dave and DevBot look great. And I actually haven't really made the last two episodes. The last two were made by an editor who I hope I can continue to work with. But I sent him a script for Dave and DevBot number 8. How many days ago now? It's been over a week. Has it been 2 weeks yet? I don't think so. Let me check. Do 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 do. There it is. Let's see, I sent it October 23rd. October 23rd was 23rd. It hasn't been 2 weeks yet. It's more like a week and a half. A week and a half and ago, and I still haven't heard back from him, which is a really long time. The last editor I had, who I thought would work out, he showed me a whole bunch of stuff. He was a better editor than I was, so I was really excited to work with him, and then he flaked out. He was working on a video I sent him. He had a couple of minutes of it done, and it looked pretty good, and then he just stopped. He just stopped sending me messages, and he was sending me messages like every other month, like, "Hey, I'm totally still working on that video." I was like, "Yeah, I'm sure you are." So I'm kind of hoping this guy doesn't flake out on me, but if he does, oh well. That's too bad. I might just need to start looking for another editor. That'd be nice. Anyways, yeah, the machinimas actually, you know, like take a long time to put together. And the thing is, they don't really get enough views to be worth the amount of time I put into them. Like, it's 100% something I do just for fun. I don't just make videos just because I want a whole bunch of views and money. Obviously, I make videos for views because I need to pay bills and stuff. But even then, I won't make a video that I absolutely just do not like. Sometimes. I will just tough it out sometimes if I know I have an idea that's going to get a lot of views, like the 107 facts video. But behind that, the top 10 videos, I usually have some fun with them. Like, they're not the worst thing in the world to do, and I know they get views, so, like, why wouldn't I do that? It's like if you could make money by just, I don't know, walking to the store and buying a soda. It's like, well, I'd rather, take the car, but I don't mind walking. And I do kind of like soda. That's such a bad example. But what I'm trying to say is, it's not like I make it sometimes sound like it's the worst thing in the world to make videos that I'm not passionate for just because they're gonna get views. It's more like, well, I don't mind making these videos and they get lots of views, so why shouldn't I? Why should I make a whole bunch of them? Well, because you'll run out of ideas eventually. I still have tons of ideas, but there's still always the thing that I might run out of ideas someday. That's not really an issue though. I have so many ideas and I can always just redo videos. Remaster them. Plus I have a huge list of ideas. Huge list of video ideas. I don't think I'll ever run out. I keep adding stuff to it. But yeah, Dave and DevBot, it's just something I do for fun. But it takes a long time, so I basically have to work on those during my free time schedule, even though they go out on my main channel. The main one that, I don't know. How much of the income does come from the channel? I don't really like to talk about money. I said in my last one that I wouldn't talk about the money anymore. So let's not go into that. It's not a really good idea to let people know. Because, you see, with YouTubers, our job is to entertain the viewers. And part of the entertainment thing is to not make it seem like it's a business. I mean, it absolutely is a business for some people, but you really don't want to give off the illusion that it is. Just because it's not really necessary, people don't need to know, and it's not going to affect them unless, someone's just being a shill and doing a sponsored video like for Game of War and telling you how great it is, even though it's just a shitty mobile game. Like that stuff, yeah, you should totally be worried about that. But otherwise, if they're just making videos because you like them and stuff, it's not really a good idea to be talking about how it's business and shit. And I don't really do that ever in any of my actual videos, but I do that quite a bit in my Q&As, so I've been trying to just, not do that anymore. I mean, I still will, but I'm not gonna go into it in detail like I have in the past. So, Dave and DevBot, number 7. Shit, this video's kinda long. I am going to make this video under an hour, no matter what. Okay, so number 7, it's the one where they go fishing and they have an adventure by just fishing because, fishing's super fun. It's actually about the backstories behind DevBot and Dave. It shows two different backstories in DevBot's version. No. In Dave's version, he talks about how he went over and killed a strong warrior named Devin, and now he put his soul into a robot's body, and that's how DevBot was born. And then DevBot's like, that's not what happened at all. And then he tells his backstory about the day he was turned on and how Dave built him because he knew he was going crazy. Because if you know the lore behind Black Dragons, Rathion is the only Black Dragon that's not insane. All other ones went insane while in their eggs. That's why Rathion is a special snowflake. He is actually kind of a big deal. And he plays an important part and role because of that. He's the only non-corrupted Black Dragon. Dave in this fan fiction story is a black dragon, so if he wasn't insane, that would also make him a special snowflake. But he is. He's totally insane. Anyone who watches the series knows he's completely nuts. And the backstory tries to give some kind of legitimacy to that. Try to make it seem like the entire video is just a setup to a joke. Like, it shows two very possible backstories to how these two people met. Because in the previous 6 videos, because this is number 7 already, they do a whole bunch of stuff that a normal person would not be able to do. Like go into a town and kill a bunch of people, or go to the moon and kill a god. Like, they're both really strong people, so obviously they must have some kind of backstories. Like, how do these two people meet? Because it seems like DevBot doesn't even like Dave anyway, and if he really was made by him, like he says all the time, and I guess he has no choice but to follow him around. So, the two backstories I made were to make it seem like they could both be possible solutions, like they could both totally fit with what happened to both of them, like on why they're both crazy and strong. And both of them are wrong, and that was basically the end to the video. It's like I tried to make both of the backstories as super serious as possible. That way I could just make a joke at the end about how they just completely ignore them and talk about something else. It's like, yeah, we just talked about this super sad backstory about how Dave was able to push back his sanity for a couple of years while he built a robot, and then he finally went insane the day he built it. Pretty sad, sappy backstory, except you don't have any idea if any of those are true or not, because they just start talking about the Illuminati at the end of the video. At the original script, I had them talk about the lizard people, but I had lizard people in the previous video. Because you see, the thing is, in my original scripts for Dave and DevBot, they did not talk. DevBot did not talk about conspiracy theories anywhere near as much. I added those in due to popular demand. Lots of people like DevBot's conspiracy theories. So I added in more conspiracy theory jokes, which made me change some parts of my later scripts. The fishing script was a lot funnier because he hadn't talked about conspiracy theories in a while, except in episode 6 he goes off about the lizard people controlling the government, and it's kind of the same exact ending as number 6, but I think it's a better video just because they tell two really sappy backstories and then they just completely ignore it and talk about something ridiculous. I think that was the joke I was going for. I don't know if really people... It's not a very good joke, but I thought it would be hilarious. And I don't really know if two people got it or not. A lot of people just seem to really like the backstories. I was like, oh, well, I mean, I did put a lot of work into making them seem really dramatic and sad. But it was all just to set up a joke that I didn't really think a lot of people would get, because it's kind of a stupid joke anyway. If you don't get it, don't sweat it. It's a dumb joke that only I think will be funny, because I make these videos basically for myself, because I like them. And I thought that would be a funny joke, just to have two super serious backstories only for them just to ignore it and talk about something else. It's like, no, are we going to, you know, go on this conversation, continue on with our backstories? No, let's just, you know, pretend the conversation never happened and talk about the Illuminati, because that's funny. All right. So yeah, that's Dave and DevBot. There are going to be more videos. Like I said, I sent the script and everything for him to make it a week and a half ago, but I haven't heard back from him. So if not, I'll just make the video myself while I look for another editor. I had someone else contact me when I made the last Q&A video like 2 months ago, I think, asking for people if they wanted to be editors. That way I can have them make Dave and DevBot. Someone else got back to me. I might just shoot them a message to see if they're still interested or not. Because the thing is, for Dave and DevBot, it takes a long time, and you kind of have to know what you're doing. And here's the big thing, I can't really pay you a lot, because I don't make a lot of money. I usually just use like a lot of my Patreon money for that, because what's the point of having, you know, a Patreon if you're not going to use the money to reinvest into your channel? And I think that's the perfect thing for Patreon, is to use the money to pay for more videos. So obviously I can pay you, but just not a lot. It's not enough to really be worth your time unless you just really want to do it. I'm also going to lose a lot of money on it, because I make like nothing off the Dave and DevBot videos. Basically, I actually have the numbers right here, because I also promised to pay my last editor 50% of whatever the Dave and DevBot videos make every month for like the next 3 months, in addition to just the down payment, which is a lot more. It's still not a lot of money, but I'm going to just spend the money on the channel, because I think that's, you know, a good way to actually spend the money. And my last two Dave and DevBot videos made me... let me look up the number real quick. Shit, where's that email at? I had written down and everything. Oh, there it is. Oh yeah, the last two videos made me a grand total. Okay, you're gonna have to hold your hats for this one. $3.40. Oh yeah, rolling in dough. Oh my god, that's so bad. Considering how much work went into it. Yeah, so Yeah, Dave and Dev is not going to make me rich. In fact, I'm going to lose a lot of money on it, but I'm fine with that because there are some people who really like it. Some people who support the Patreon do it pretty much just because they like Dave and Dev bot. So I'm going to keep putting them out no matter what. It's just if I have an editor, they'll come out quicker because they take too long to make and I am pretty busy. In fact, actually, you know what? Let me talk about my schedule for the week. I have it, like, I record my schedule every week on Google Calendars. Let me see. Can I change it to a week format? Yes, I can. For the last week. Oh, shit. That's right. I had. Last week was kind of busy. It's not a typical week. Because it was Halloween and shit. So usually, I should say, on a usual week, not like last week. Last week, I spent a lot of time working on the Enter the Cribs videos. Because it looks like on Sunday, I spent all day working on my vampire video. On Monday, woke up at 11. Went to the store, did some stuff, worked on my vampire video from 2 to 5:30, took an hour break, played Heroes for 2 hours, played Yu-Gi-Oh for videos, did pet battles for Yu-Gi-Oh for videos, played Yu-Gi-Oh for 2 more hours at night, and then after 12 o'clock, I don't work anymore. I just read or watch anime. Usually, I've been reading a lot lately. And then on Tuesday, I woke up, went running, and then I started working on Into the Crypts from 12:30 to 10 o'clock at night, and then I played Heroes for the last 2 hours, and then I didn't do anything after 12. Then on Wednesday, I woke up, I spent an hour to cool down, get ready, go running, and then I worked on Into the Crypts from 2 to 7, and then I raided from 7 to 10, and then I did pet battles in Yu-Gi-Oh! Because I do a lot of pet battle and Yu-Gi-Oh! Stuff. My pet battle channel is my third most popular channel, but it's way below the numbers my Yu-Gi-Oh! And WoW channel put out. My WoW channel, on average, gets about 500,000 views a month, like 500,000, which is pretty good. My Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel, on average, gets about 200,000 views a month. That's a little bit less than my WoW channel, but that's like an average, sometimes a little bit higher. My WoW channel, it fluctuates by a couple hundred thousand every month. Like 500,000 is like the minimum. It usually goes a little bit higher, sometimes like around 700,000 to 800,000. Never hits 1 million though. It gets really close sometimes. And my Yu-Gi-Oh channel, it's pretty consistent around 200,000. And then my Pet Battle channel being the third most popular channel, since I've got 500,000 and then 200,000, my third most popular channel must be doing really great, right? Well, my Pet Battle channel gets about 20,000 views a month. It's 10% of my Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel, which has less than half of my WoW channel. So my third most popular channel, with 20,000 views a month, is not that much, but it's still a lot higher than my other like five channels that are lucky to get 1,000 views a month. But then again, those are all like brand new channels anyway. I don't expect them to do well, yet. And some of them I don't ever expect to do well. I do those 100% just for fun. So yeah, on my list I have lots of time put out for Yu-Gi-Oh! Because that's one of my. It's a significant source of views for me. It would be stupid to ignore that. I'm actually like really, I'm one of the bigger channels on the Yu-Gi-Oh! Side of YouTube. But actually, yeah, I do about just as well as all the big guys, except one person. There's one guy in the Yu-Gi-Oh! Side of YouTube named Asian Eyes White Dragon. He's like the PewDiePie of Yu-Gi-Oh! YouTube. He gets way more views than everyone else. He gets about 2 million views a month, like double my two channels put together. Yeah, no one else comes close to him. Everyone else has numbers around my Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel, like 200,000 views a month. So yeah, my Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel does very well for itself. It's like one of the big guys over there, but none of them can reach the PewDiePie YouTube. Asian Eyes White Dragon. He's a pretty cool guy though. I have nothing but respect for people who do well on YouTube. Who, don't completely aren't douchebags and stuff. He's a cool guy. Yeah. So anyways, let's see. On to On to Thursday. Looks like I woke up at 11 to go running, cool down, and I worked on Into the Crypts again. Yeah. And then I went to the fair on Friday. Then I played Heroes from 7 to 12. How many hours is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. I played Heroes of the Storm for 5 hours after that. And I think I played for another 5 hours on Halloween, too. I love to play Heroes of the Storm in my downtime. Alright, let's go to the week before that. This one had a lot more of a stuff. So, on Sunday, I wrote Into the Crypts. On Monday, I worked on a video for my awesome Top 10s channel from 12 to 3 for about 3 hours. Then I took an hour break, because breaks are very important. Are actually very important. I'm not just saying that because I like to take breaks. They're a really good way to make you do more work if you just take small breaks in the day. It's like the best thing you can do for yourself. It tricks your brain to thinking you've taken a longer break than you really have. It allows you to work basically at peak performance again as soon as the break is over. So force yourself to take breaks if you work for yourself like I do. And then I made one Yu-Gi-Oh! Video. Oh shit, I need to make a Yu-Gi-Oh! Video today. And then I made 3 unfunny joke videos, and I took a break, and then I did pet stuff at night. And then on Tuesday, ooh, this is a loaded schedule. Let's say I woke up and went running, and then I did a Yu-Gi-Oh! Videos, and then I played Heroes of the Storm recording, and then I read some Reddit pages for my Reddit channel, took an hour break, and then I did pet spotlights, took another break, played Yu-Gi-Oh! For 3.5 hours, and then I played Metroid at night. Now the day after that, I woke up, watched anime and shit, that's what I have written down. Played Heroes, played Metroid, played Yu-Gi-Oh! For 3 hours, I raided, and then I played Yu-Gi-Oh! For 2 hours after that. And the day after that, woke up, went running, played Yu-Gi-Oh! For 3.5 hours, took a break, did grunt work, that means I finished recording Yu-Gi-Oh! And that either means I put it in the editor, or I was making fucking thumbnails, because I hate making thumbnails, but I make thumbnails for 3 of my channels. I make thumbnails for 4 of my channels now. I make thumbnails for my WoW channel, my Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel, my Pet Battle channel, and my other Top 10s channel. They're the ones I don't bother, because making thumbnails is a pain in the ass. I don't like doing it, but it makes your video look better. So, that's what I call grunt work. And I spent an hour and a half making thumbnails for my videos. Making thumbnails, putting up, like, tags and shit. It's just, you know, checking emails, replying to comments. That's what I have under grunt work. I even schedule that out. And then I raid, and then I took a break after raid, which means I probably read Reddit, and then I did more grunt work at night. Damn, I had lots of grunt work to do on Thursday. And then on Friday, I woke up, went running, did my storyboard for Dave and Dev number 8. Oh yeah, that was a week and a half ago when I sent it out to him. And then I did the vampire video from 1:30 in the afternoon to 12 at night. Damn, that's right, I spent a long time on that video. So yeah, I have everything planned out. And to put it in, like, I really didn't need to read all those out. It probably just glossed over it. You probably just glossed over when I was reading all that anyway. Basically, I have all my channels, and I proportion my time in relation to, what the channel's worth. Like, I don't spend a lot of time with the channels that don't get a lot of views, because I don't really expect them to. And I spend a majority of my time working on the bigger channels, like a lot of those things where lots of hours put into playing Yu-Gi-Oh!, lots more hours into making stuff for my WoW channel. It's basically like 25% of my time is spent making Yu-Gi-Oh! Videos, 10% is spent making Pet Battle videos. Luckily, Pet Battle videos are really easy to make. And let's see, that's 35% right there. So then I have like another 20% on all my other channels. And then the last 45% is on my WoW channel. So I have the largest majority of my time is spent on my WoW channel, just because the videos I make for this channel take a long time to make. And I spend about 20% of my time on, you know, like 5 of my other channels combined. And then, you know, like 25% on my Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel, because it does really well. And about 10% on my Pet Battle channel. Even that, I think it might be like 5%. and I could just bump up my WoW channel to like 50%. I have the time scheduled out, so the other channels I have, if I stopped making them, yeah, I could probably make more WoW videos, but at the same time, I don't want all my eggs in one basket, and I do want to kind of branch out, so it's more like an investment in the future. That being said, the channels that I have made on the other ones, the only ones I don't expect to ever do well, and I do 100% for fun, are the Heroes of the Storm channel and the Metroid one. Those two I do just for fun. The Metroid channel is just something I do because I love... I really liked playing Metroid growing up. Like, Metroid Fusion on my Game Boy Advance is, like, my favorite game. It's probably, like, one of my most favorite games ever. And then Metroid Zero Mission, I really liked that too. And since I really liked those games, I always wanted to play other games like them, but I could never really find them. I never actually really played Castlevania. And then I played a couple other Metroidvania games later on, once I started making the channel. Metroid, because I don't... Usually if I have free time, I'll play Heroes of the Storm, and I don't really ever spend that time playing other games. So with the channel, I'm basically forced to play other Metroidvania games, and I'm really glad I did, because I found some really good ones. Ori and the Blind Forest, it's probably like one of my favorite games ever. It's one of the Metroidvania games I played for the channel, and it is so good. Holy crap, I would have never played that game if it wasn't for the channel. And then there's some other games, you know, I just slowly play through them. I spent like 5 hours on Sunday just playing Super Metroid. Not 5 hours, like 3 hours. 5 hours is too much. I had planned to spend about that much time, but I actually spent about 2 hours of that time on Reddit and watching YouTube videos and shit. So it didn't really pan out. But yeah, that channel I do for fun. And Heroes of the Storm, I just play that all the time for fun. Like I said, if it wasn't for the Metroid channel, I'd probably just play Heroes of the Storm on my free time. Because I used to be really into Dota 2. And Dota 2 is hard as shit. And a normal, quick game took about 40 minutes. And Heroes of the Storm, a long game, takes 40 minutes. It's great. You can sometimes have games over in 15 minutes. And it's just really fun. I really like not having to last hit either. Because I really hated last hitting in Dota 2. And denying. I do miss Dota 2 sometimes, like for the heroes and shit. But I don't miss the game lengths. At all. Like, some of the characters in Dota 2 are really fun, though. I really wish there was a character that played like Tinker. I don't think that's possible, though, because there's no items. But whatever. Heroes of the Storm is my go-to game to have fun. But I also play a whole bunch of single-player games because of my Metroidvania channel. So, I really like those. Those two I just do for fun. The Heroes Ask Reddit, where I just read Ask Reddit threads. I didn't expect anything in that channel either. It's like... It's more like I love reading Ask Reddit threads anyway. And I thought that would be a good way to practice script reading. And it was. I've gotten way better at reading scripts for my videos, I should say. It was a good way to practice voice acting. And I've gotten really better at, you know, speaking out loud while reading from scripts. Because of reading for those videos. Because a lot of the people who do those, you know, have... like bad grammar, or they spell things wrong or something, so I've gotten really good at just like reading on the fly, reading lots of incorrectly read stuff. It's like, you know, because you're reading stuff from real people, you know, writing out responses to questions, and it's really great practice. Holy crap. It's also not doing half bad. Like, that's like one of the three channels I made that I didn't expect to do well, and it's not doing half bad, actually, so I have some expectations for it. Not zero, like I do for the Heroes of the Storm and Metroid channel, which I do just for fun. And then, since I don't have a zero expectation for Metroid, I mean for my Reddit channel, I do have expectations for my Top 10 channel and my Jokes channel, but they're still new. And they're getting about as many views as I thought they would. So, those two channels, while still really small, are doing about as well as I thought they would. I really need to put out more videos for my Top 10 channel, but... that one, I would actually really like to hire editors for that, too. Just to put it off the floor. Get it off the ground, I mean. I know the channel can do well if I just put out more videos. But I'd have to find a way to schedule more time for that. Like, after I'm done making this Q&A video, I'm probably going to go work on that. Make a video for that channel, because I didn't make one last week. Because I spent all last week making the Into the Crypts video, because that one took about 7 days total to make. 3 days to write the script, 4 days to, you know, put the video together. That was a doozy. Alright. So yeah, that's my typical work week. I spend a lot of time working, but a lot of the work I do is fun, so it's pretty great. I love my job. Oh, I'm going to drink water real quick. Alright, well, I had planned for this to be less than an hour, but I think it's going to go a little bit longer than that. So, I actually had a couple other stuff I wanted to talk about on my list. I spent way too long talking about my schedule. Let's see, I got sponsored by Yaktronics, this one website. You see, the thing is, I get, like, sponsorship emails all the time, but I just ignore them. Because usually it's for, like, stupid shit that I don't care about. Like, I get gold sellers who contact me all the time, want me to advertise their gold selling websites. I'm like, yeah, no. I mean, I don't reply to them, I just ignore them. I found over my years in YouTube that it's a lot easier just to ignore stuff than it would be to write out responses to everything. Just because of the amount of shit I get every day. It's just a huge waste of time. And I also get things from people who want... I don't know, I just get a bunch of random shit. There's this one, you know, like those survey websites? You know, they want you to sign up and do surveys and shit. They contact me a lot, too. I ignore those as well, though. I mean, you can, like, the survey sites aren't scams or anything. It's just, it's a huge waste of your time. Because usually those ones, they have you, like, sign up, and then they'll send you a survey if you qualify. And usually you have to go and take a short survey to see if you qualify or not for the survey. And then they'll usually just tell you, no, you actually don't fit our recommendations for the survey. So, try again later. You know, come back to us. Fill out a survey for us. And then we'll tell you if you qualify to do a survey for us. And if you qualify, we'll give you money. So, I mean, yeah, they will give you the money. They usually do. I don't think I've ever ran into problems with that, because I used to do surveys like that for money back in the day before. Actually, that's how I started my YouTube channel. Was the very first video I ever made on YouTube was a testimonial video for this website called Prize Rebel, where you basically just filled out surveys. And I even made a video about how to do the surveys. Made about a cool $100 doing that. Making money on YouTube before you could make money on YouTube. That was way back in the day, though. Yeah, so I usually ignore those, but these guys that came to me, and they're like, hey, do you want to, you know, put like a little thing at the end of your video, at the end of some of your videos, not all of them, like, you know, the ones that I know will do well, you know, just talking about going to our site and, you know, talk about the stuff we sell. So I checked them out, and they sell basically just Razer Nagas, headsets, gaming mouses, keypads, whatever, and I'm like, you know what, this looks totally legit. I mean, people who play WoW, usually a lot of them use Razer Naga mouses. I personally don't have one, because until very recently I've been like ridiculously poor, and I'm still in the ridiculously poor mindset, but a lot of the friends I have who play WoW all have Razer Naga mouses, and I've been wanting to get one for a while. So like, wow, this is like, you know, the perfect thing, because I actually don't mind. I don't mind telling people to go to this website who does custom designs for mouses that people who play WoW are going to use anyway. If I was ever to do a sponsorship, this is totally something I would do. So I told them, sure. And the terms are easy. They're really cool about it. They're all really nice people. So at the end of some of my videos, I'll talk about them. And I also put a link to their website in all of my videos from now on. So yeah, that's what that's about. I don't really have to, you know, make a specific video for them or anything. They sell mouses and headsets and stuff. Stuff you'd use if you're going to play video games online anyway. So it's actually, like, really good. It's kind of like if Konami came to my Yu-Gi-Oh! Channel and was like, hey, would you like to talk about, you know, Yu-Gi-Oh! Packs that are about to come out? And then we'll pay you money for it? I'd be like, I mean, my channel's about Yu-Gi-Oh! So yes, why wouldn't I? I guess another example would be like if Blizzard came to me and be like, hey, do you want to make videos about World of Warcraft? It's like, I do that anyway. So yeah, that's what that's about. Let's see, and then streams. I have that written down on here. I stream on Wednesdays at around 7 o'clock. That's when I do my raid. We do like farm stuff. I think we're going to be working on Heroic Archimonde or whatever. Because every time I stream on Saturday on YouTube, people always ask me why I don't stream on Twitch. And then I tell them I do stream on Twitch. I stream on Twitch on Wednesdays, it's just no one comes. That's not true. I do have like one or two people who show up. Most of the time though, there's no one else in the room and I'm just by myself, talking to myself. It's really lonely. No one ever wants to watch me raid, but then again, raiding, when you're just doing farm, heroic content isn't the most exciting thing to watch in the world, and it's basically just because, hey, I'm gonna be playing this anyway, and doing farm content's kinda boring. So if you want to come and chat in real time, because I don't chat in real time anywhere else, if I give you my battle.net password, I mean battle.net thing, like I have this thing where I don't give it out except under special occasions, and if I do give it out to some people, I tell them pretty much the same thing. Do not ever send me a message in-game, because I will ignore you, and if you keep doing it, I'm going to remove you. Because usually when I'm in-game, it's because I'm getting footage, and if you send me a message, it's going to ruin it sometimes. Also, when I'm in-game, it's because, you know, I'm getting footage, and I'm busy, and I'm working, and I don't have time to have a conversation with you. It's not that I'm trying to be mean or anything. It's just, you know, this is a special situation. I usually just don't give it out to anyone. So, don't talk to me, because I'm busy. And conversations require input from both people. And I probably am not in the mood for it. But then again, there are some times. Like, if I'm playing Heroes of the Storm, feel free to send me a message. Because that's basically what I give out my Battle.net for, is to play Heroes of the Storm with people. Because playing Heroes is totally something you want to do with other people. It's just every time I go on Heroes, no one else is ever on it. So I'm like, ugh. It'd be so nice if I had friends to queue up with. This would make the game so much more fun, considering it's a team-based game. And I'm always playing with random pugs. But yeah, so the stream on Wednesdays, basically, if you want to, you know, there's lots of people who just really want to have conversations with me. That's the best place to do it in real time, because there's really no other way to talk to me in real time rather than my streams. And I usually respond to everything because not too many people show up to them, so that's what that's about. If you really want to ask me questions or something, just show up to one of my two streams on Saturday, I mean Wednesdays or Saturdays. Wednesdays at 7 Arizona time, and oh wait, it might be 8 now because the daylight savings changed. Yeah, the stream, like, my time doesn't change, but everyone else's does, so they change the time that the raid goes. Like, I didn't even know how daylight savings worked until I started raiding, because I never had to do anything with it. And then on Saturdays, that won't be the same. I start streaming around either 1 or 2 in the afternoon. Arizona time, of course. Just type that in. It'll tell you exactly when the time zone is compared to yours, because Arizona time is a legit time, because we don't observe daylight savings, so we have our own little time zone. Okay. Now, on to questions from last time, the actual Q&A portion of this, an hour into the video. I still wanted to keep this video under an hour no matter what. Okay, first question. From iTsunsiko26. Hey Hiro, I have a question for you. Do you have any tips I can help with depression? I'm currently suffering from depression and have been watching a lot of your videos, and they're absolutely hilarious. I'm just wondering if you had anything to recommend to help with my pain. Okay, so I actually get messages like this all the time, surprisingly. I'm pretty sure a lot of YouTubers do. Because, I mean, basically we put out entertainment, and usually you watch entertainment when you want to be entertained. And a lot of depressed people go on, I know I do, if I'm in a really bad mood, I'll go on YouTube and watch funny videos to lift my spirits. A lot of the videos I make are pretty funny, so I'm pretty sure a lot of YouTubers get these kinds of messages too. Basically, do I have tips for depression, considering my study into psychology and how I was going for a degree in psychology before I took a break from school, plus lots of self-study and going through depression 2 times myself? Do I have any tips? Well, not really. See, the thing is, there's a lot of different types of depression. It all really depends, like, what your kind is, because some of them are legit just like medical problems. Like, you have chemicals wrong with your brain and you just need to go get medication to fix that. So my best advice would be, like, go see a therapist, because they'll either give you medication or refer you to, like, a counselor who you can talk with. And usually talking about your problems is a good way to help. Because the thing is, a lot of people in general, not just depressed people, they think that their problems have only ever happened to them and that no one else has ever experienced what they've gone through. Like, I mean, when I say it like that, obviously everyone's gonna be like, well, I don't think like that. But it's ridiculously common. The best way to help someone who's in a stressful situation or who's, you know, feeling sad or something is to not tell them about other people who have a worse time, but to tell them about other people who are basically going through the exact same thing they are and how normal it is. People love to be told how normal they are. I've used that a lot of times and it's worked every single time. But I haven't really had to deal with any, you know, major cases or anything. I'm really good at dealing with people just because I know all the, you know, tricks behind how people's brains work because of all of the self-research into psychology. I'm not going to call myself an expert, not in any stretch of the imagination. I just know more than the average person because I've taken an active interest in the subject. So yeah, do I have any tips? Well, it all really depends on like what it is, because depression is such like a blanket term. Some people will say they're depressed if they're just feeling sad for a day or something. Usually it's like a medical problem, but sometimes if you're willing to work on it, then you're a lot more towards the recovery door than someone who just can't. Because usually depressed people, they think they're going to be like this forever and there's nothing they can do. That's why they don't get help, because they think there's nothing that's going to work anyway, so why should they bother wasting time? You know, that sounds, you know, stupid in theory. And when you say it out loud like that, but so many of these people have that internalized that that's exactly how it is. Even though pretty much every problem is fixable, even problems you think aren't fixable, because when you're stuck in the depressive mindset, it's really hard to think of anything else. That's like, depression is like a self-spiral that, you know, just collapses in on itself, never really fixes itself. It just keeps reaffirming negative connotations about the world views, and just keeps reaffirming them. Every time you see something little bad happen, it's like, well, yeah, that's just the way the world is. I guess I'm just meant to not be happy ever. And they'll just internalize it and only ever think about bad stuff. I mean, sometimes legitimately bad stuff happens to people, but if all you ever do is focus on the bad stuff, of course you're ever only going to see bad stuff. But then again, focusing on the good stuff, even if there's very little of it, takes a completely different kind of mindset that people who are depressed just don't have. Say like, ooh, I walked outside today and there was a nice breeze. What a nice breeze. Oh, this is actually pretty great. I love how I don't have cancer right now. I mean, it could be worse. I could have cancer and be dying, but I'm not, and the world isn't that bad. Sure, I might have some financial problems. I might not be in a relationship. The person I was in love with may not love me back. You know, typical things that throw people into depression. But it could be, well, actually, you know, the it could be worse thing is a really bad thing. I always go out of my way to avoid that, and I can't believe I just almost use that as an example. If someone is depressed, never tell them it could be worse. That is the worst thing you can do. Never, ever, not even like by mistake. You have to actively avoid that kind of stuff. So yeah, what I did personally, what I can just tell you from my personal experiences, the two times I was depressed, and the third time when I was able to get out of it myself before it actually happened, the first time was over problems with a girl. And I manages to turn off my emotions, and that seemed to do the problem. I mean, seemed to do the trick. I mean, if you can't feel anything, it's kind of hard to feel sad about anything because you don't feel anything about anything. So that worked for me, but I don't recommend it. But then again, if you're always in pain, I mean, I guess that's a good way to get out of it, but I don't suggest it. The second way is I just kind of, well, the problems that made me depressed in the first place resolved itself. Like, it was no longer a problem and I was able to work things out with the person. So that's something that, you know, can't really give advice on. It's not like I really did something. I was just a huge, huge bitch for like 6 months. And I had a friend who helped me through it, and she is absolutely the best. She's the one who I like shouted out her whatchamacallit, her cosplay channel a while ago. I don't know, how long ago was that? It was a couple months ago, actually. Not even like 6 months ago. Yeah, she helped me through that depression. She was super cool. I was a huge bitch about everything. I don't know how the hell she put up with me. I was the most whiny, annoying person in the world. Great friend. I owe her for life because of that. But yeah, I had great support from friends, and I was able just to resolve the problems. I got over it that way. The third time was when I got fired from the job. I got attacked while I was out on my run, so I was suffering from PTSD, and I was having problems with some of my interpersonal relationships. So I knew I was heading down to depression because I just had a whole bunch of really bad things happening to me all at once. So what I did to combat that was I took an active change in my lifestyle, because before then all I did was really just went to work and played WoW, and I didn't really have work anymore, so I guess all I did was just play WoW. So I changed up my lifestyle. First thing I did was I went to a Yu-Gi-Oh! Tournament, a locals event. I grabbed a deck I had from high school. I looked online to see what the ban changes were like, to see if I could still play the deck I had or not, because out of all my friends in high school, I was the only one with a competitive deck, and I rarely ever used it because I just won all the time if I used it, because it just countered theirs completely. And I looked it up, and turns out only a few of the cards in my deck were banned, so I was able to use pretty much the entire thing. I took it to locals. I never actually went before because I took place on Sundays and I always worked on the weekends, so I could never actually go to one before because the times are always just, I'd have to take a day off. I've always wanted to go to one, but I never actually did because, for one, I always worked on that day, and two, they're really far away from my house. And I didn't really have the cards or the money to really go into that competitively, but I was like, I need to do stuff that I've always wanted to do, but I've always put off. So this was the first thing I did. I went to a Yu-Gi-Oh! Tournament, and I won 3 games, lost 2. I did really well. I went 3-2. Turns out, the deck I had from back in high school, which won all the time because it countered all my opponent's decks, I mean my friend's decks, also counted all the good decks in the meta. The Macro Monarch deck. Oh my god, it's so good. Basically, if you open up with the key cards of the deck, you're going to win because it removes the graveyard from the play. And without the graveyard, they can't get any of their effects off. The thing is, that deck, you can't play it anymore today, but when I was, you know, going to the tournament, it was a perfectly viable deck, and I won 3 games because of it. Well, I mean, I say 3 games. It's more like you have matches. Basically, in order to win a game, you have to win best 2 of 3. So I won a lot more than just one, you know, 3 duels. I won like, I had to have won at least 2 for each one of those. So I won more than 6. 6 duels with that deck. Pretty good deck. I also didn't really have any side cards. And the deck is really easy to side against too, so. Yeah, I got pretty lucky with that. So I was able to do that, and I won pretty nicely. And I was like, okay, that was fun. That was a pretty nice change of pace. Second thing I did was I started making YouTube videos, because I used to make them back in the day and I've always wanted to make them, but I never really had the time or the know-how on how to actually make them. So what I did was I just went in and started making them. The first video I made was like, it was basically a copy of Pyrian Flax's Dota 2 guides, where he'd make a very sarcastic guide about a hero from Dota 2. And he'd use MS Paint drawings for everything, so it's basically one of those, but for WoW. And it was like a sarcastic MS Paint drawing guide to Dispriest. It's a really bad video, but I mean, I had a lot of fun making it. It took a lot of time to do, and when you put a whole bunch of time and energy into a creative effort, it really makes you forget about all your troubles. And I had a lot of fun with that. And then I just kept making videos, and then I eventually just got over it. I mean, that's not all it was, but I just made a change of lifestyle. And it eventually led to a really fun job I have now. But that's what I did, but I don't. That's not like the be-all, end-all for how to help with depression. But it's also not a bad thing to try. Just throw yourself into something you've always wanted to try before. Alright. Ooh. Okay, next up, next question. Void Shrine says, do the Tyrion storyline lore. It's my favorite for sure. I know, Void Shrine, I've got that on a list of videos to make. It'll come out within the next month or two. Razz33 says, hey Hero, will you ever do something like playthrough or leveling series with any YouTuber or your friend? I really want to see that. Well, I was thinking of doing something like that, except the problem is I don't have friends, so I can't really do a playthrough leveling series with another person if I don't have any friends to do that with. I mean, I have friends, but they're all busy with their lives and stupid gay shit like that. So I don't have any friends to actually play WoW anymore. I have lots of friends that I met in WoW, but none of them really played anymore, which is kind of sad. And I've been meaning to make some more friends, that way I can play Heroes of the Storms with them, because I really want to like have a 5-stack for Heroes of the Storm. That'd be fun. But then there's the problems with having a 5-stack in Heroes of the Storm, is the fact that, you know, I only really like to go on to play Heroes for like an hour at most. And I'd have to go on, get all these people into a group, which takes a while, then we'd play like one or two games, and I would just bail out. I'd feel obligated to stay in, so there are problems with getting more people to play with. Sure, it would be fun, but there's that whole social obligation that you have to play with them longer than you really can, and it's just something I do for fun anyway, so I don't really mind playing by myself, because I know what goes into actually playing with a group of people. But yeah, will I ever do a playthrough or leveling series? Maybe. That seems like it'd be an easy way to just get videos on the channel and get, I don't expect them to get any good views, but considering how many views my stream VODs get, I think there's some potential in that. Not like an everyday thing, maybe like 2 times a week or maybe, I don't know. Usually right now I only release like 2 videos at most every week. Getting some more in there is something I do want to do. Let's see, Void Shrine again says, well, when you get bigger, intros are great because you'll get featured more, and if someone recognizes a pattern in your videos, it'll be interesting. Like, if 2 recommended videos are yours and someone watches them, then on the 3rd one, they see the same intro, they think, huh, this is the same guy, I'll check out his other vids. Oh, that's a good way to think of it. I never thought of it like that. I guess that is a good argument for having intros, because I have a lot of quick click-through. Like, I get tons of traffic from the YouTube suggested video, but I don't get a high subscriber ratio from them. Like, lots of people will watch my videos, but not a lot of people will actually subscribe after watching them. So I have a really low subscriber through rate than I really should have, considering how many views I get. I get way more views than someone who has the same amount of subscribers I have. Alright, next one, from Doron Movies. I've done some research on the top 10s. Apparently, it's a subconscious thing that attracts people. Mainly because people know before they click that there's going to be a structure. They have the general idea of what to expect, and also they can test their knowledge and see if they knew some stuff or not. That is also the reason why some people are super nitpicky when it comes to them. Oh, that's so true. I get, like, comments every day about people nitpicking my top 10 videos. That reminds me of my top 10 Warcraft Vampires video. That was one when I saw the script and I was going to go and make it. I was like, this video has no potential for a video. Like, literally, there are only 2 types of vampires in game. It's the Dark Fallen and the Nathrezim, the Dreadlords. And of those two, the Dreadlords have lots of lore, but I don't really want to make it all about the Dreadlords because it's about vampires and I wanted to have a higher Dark Fallen to Dreadlord ratio, but there's not, like, any lore at all in the Dreadlords. I mean, the Dark Fallen, so it's like, that. I can't really make a video about this. There's literally not enough information. And it took me way longer than it really should have to write the script for that. I was able to put out a video that was somewhat interesting, but I thought the video was just a dead idea. I was like, I thought this could be a good idea, but once I did the research for it, I was like, there's not really anything here. Ugh, man, I keep coughing. I'm gonna take another water break. Oh, man. Turns out talking for an hour straight dries out your throat for some reason. All right. Doron's movie has some more stuff to it. Okay, also, I can agree about a lot of stuff when it comes to YouTube, but you just cover so many different topics that I forget what I was going to comment. When it comes to full-time YouTube, I'm in a way lucky, since the only good thing about living in Siberia is that the cost of almost everything is much smaller than other countries. So even with a small channel, you can earn the average wage. Bad thing is getting a real job is not really a thing even with my university degree. Oh, that's sad. And lastly, I so agree on the Battle.net thing. I started doing it, and now my friends list is almost full, and people used to message me all the time. Luckily, most people listen, I barely get any whispers now. But after one stream was ridiculous, like 10 whispers every time I logged in. Or people commenting every time I change zones when I record stuff. The worst thing is I get myself in weird positions since I sound like such a pretentious douche and I tell people not to whisper me, when in reality, almost no YouTubers really get themselves in that position. Doron's movies, yeah, I know exactly what you mean. This is exactly why I don't just give out my Battle.net willy-nilly, but then again, I do sometimes because you have to in order to play Heroes of the Storm. But every time I do give it out, I give out that warning I talked about earlier. Don't ever message me. It's not because I'm being a dick or anything, but because, you know, the problems he just said right here. P.S. I could try voice acting for that role. Oh, that's for something else. Okay, Void Shrine again. Wow, he really likes to comment on these things. That's why he's one of the mods on YouTube and Twitch. This is how you become a mod for me. Comment on everything. Honestly, not because I live there, but if you were to move to Europe, go to Sweden. Some people here rabble about how the country is tearing itself apart. That's not true at all. Even statistics show the other. Sweden is a great place. It's semi-expensive, but it averages at the fourth best place to live in the world. Norway is basically the same, so it's really great, but awfully expensive. Since you're American, I suspect you hate Canada, so I won't say Vancouver. What's left is Reykjavik. The bad thing is that it's on an island and it's kind of small. Internet connection sucks there. Well, I'm pretty sure every country says that it's tearing itself apart, so that's not really something exclusive to Sweden. Since you're American, you probably hate Canada. I love Canada. My best friend's from Canada. I think she even lived in Vancouver. No, she said she lived in BC. She lives in the middle of nowhere right now, though. Which sucks. She's also in school, and, whatever, I don't want to talk about that. But yeah, I don't have anything against Canada. I wouldn't mind living in Vancouver. That seems like it'd be nice. It's nice and cold up there instead of hot shit all the time like it is here. Adam B. says, never stop doing these. Okay, Adam. The Ami says, I think it's okay if you make vids so you can make some money, so don't stop. Why, thank you, The Ami. Death Narwhal says, thanks for the awesome new video, Hiru. Smiley face. You're welcome, Deathnar. Shinbout says, Shell Shield and Cascade. Maining a disc, I just died a little inside. But I guess you're just playing casual, so I won't judge you too much. Nice video. Okay, so you see, the thing is, in the video you saw, we were doing farm content. And I have my skill set up for when we were working on Manoroth as progression. And we were working on Manoroth, and we kept wiping a bunch of time, so I just started taking random talents. Like, I don't like Spirit Shell, it's not very good. This expansion is really good last expansion, though, when it wasn't a fucking talent to pick, and they just gave it to you for being disc. But whatever. And they even gave you the fucking nerfed version of it. Oh my god, I don't like Spirit Shell. But I just wanted to try it out, and I didn't really bother changing my skills around because we were just doing farm content. It doesn't really matter what I pick. The thing with Cascade, though, apparently Cascade is, like, bugged right now. That's what this guy said, because I actually replied to him after he put this comment, where it bounces on your pets and shit, and it doesn't do as much healing as Halo, but Halo requires positioning requirements, and it's kind of a pain in the ass, so I just switched back to Cascade, because I don't like Halo. I don't care if Cascade bounces on pets and does less healing. It seems to work out just fine for me. Plus, we don't have a lot of pets in our raid anyway. James C. says, so, it's a Q&A, but no questions for the first 10 minutes. Well, this video is going to have no questions for the first hour. Todd Cobb says, what's your opinion on Mala Hunters? Melee Hunters? Seems interesting. I want to see how that works out. Pleb Nation says, I'm just watching for the heroic Hellfire gameplay. Lol. Okay. If you like farm content. X Hydrogen says, first, Kappa. Why, you might be first. John Lindersvox says, why do you always sound exhausted? That's just my voice. Rod Zikri says, I love your videos, keep it up. Why, thank you, Rod Zikri. Let's see. My dream is to have 500 subscribers without any videos, says, what is the add-on of raid frames? Of raid frames? Are you talking about Healbot? I think that's Healbot. I want to see if this guy actually has 500 subscribers. His channel name is literally, "My dream is to have 500 subscribers without any videos." So far, it looks like he has... all he has is subscribers hidden. That's a pain in the ass. Well... oh, look, there's someone who has a million subscribers with no videos. It looks like he has... help a bitch out, 1 second, 626 videos. I guess that's a thing on YouTube. Cool. Herty Dwarf says, 2651, library, Hiru, please, your eBay costs sound a little high. My mom does eBay all the time and never heard of it being that expensive. It's normally like $3 to $4 per $67 items. Why do you keep saying library? Library? I sold about... that's my reply to it. I think in my last video I talked about how I sold a shit ton of games on eBay and they ended up charging me like $150 in fees. But that's because I sold about $400 to $500 worth of stuff. But still, I took like 150 of it in fees, and I was like, fuck eBay. I mean, I'm still going to use it if I need to, because I made a lot more money than they took in fees, but I would really not pay that much in fees, because that's a ton of money to pay in fees. That's like, I don't know, almost 20% of how much I actually sold. And the last one says, second, Kappa. Okay, Disc Jockey Dark Signs, you are second, Kappa. Alright, and that's all the comments for this video, I guess? Yeah, I don't think I missed any. Let me just look through it one more time. Yep. Alright, that's it for the Q&A. If you have any questions for the next Q&A for me to read at the very end of the video after I talk about my channel for an hour, just leave it in a comment below. I read pretty much all of them.